dreamed I went to heaven, and you were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing, and someone called your name. I turned and saw this young man, and he was smiling as he came. And he said, "Friend, you may not know me now." And then he said, "But wait, you used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I have a life that was changed. Remember the time a missionary came to your church. His pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. And Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm here today. Somehow touched by your generosity. Little things you had done, the sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. And I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, "My child, look around you, for great is your reward." Was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Oh, thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. So glad you
We're here today to celebrate the life and ministry of a unique man, Dr. George D. Voris. He was a true soldier of the cross. Because of the rise in COVID cases here in North Carolina, the family did not want to endanger you or themselves by having a public get together and requested that we record this tribute. I know many of you desperately wanted to come and express your sympathies to the family and to tell your George Voris story. I want to thank Pastor Livingston and the Central Church, the staff here, for allowing us to record the service in their sanctuary because of the excellent job they do and the excellent spirit with which they serve. During this tribute, we'll be singing two of Dr. Voris' favorite songs, Amazing Grace, and also Larry Green will be closing with Midnight Cry. After a brief greeting from our general overseer, Dr. Tim Hill, I'll be coming back to speak on behalf of West North Carolina and the ministers and laypersons here and sharing just a few of the many memorial posts that were put on social media. Then Pastor Bob Gilley will be speaking as Dr. Voris' pastor and on behalf of the church and family. Lee and Tammy Storms, a former student, will be coming to share the impact that he had on their life. And then Pastor Lorraine Livingston will give his tribute to this great man of God. But let us begin this service with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the life of George David Voris. Thank you for his ministry, his family, and his legacy. Thank you for the many lives that he influenced. Only you know how many ministers he has influenced, encouraged, supported, and cheered on when they were ready to quit. Only you have a record of the number of people whose lives were touched, people who were saved, sanctified, filled with his spirit, and encouraged to serve the Lord during his active years of ministry. I pray that during the celebration of his life and ministry, that you would anoint the speakers, the singers, that those who are watching will sense your presence. As we thank you, God, for giving Dr. George Voris to us and allowing us to come into contact with him, I pray that you would touch every person who is watching as they remember this great man of God and the influence he had on them. You took him from obscurity, saved him, took him out of Catholicism, called him to preach, anointed him, and used him in a wonderful way to influence the Church of God. And we're grateful for that. And I pray that your spirit will rest upon us this afternoon. In Jesus' name, amen.
Rain. I want to take a few moments today to greet the family and loved ones of Dr. George Voris. I also want to greet every minister and the laity who have gathered either online or in person to honor a man of God. You know, there are people around this world today, ministers, who are preaching the gospel because not only of the call of God upon their life, but because of the faithful instruction and teaching of Dr. Voris. Just like we read in the Bible in the Old Testament, where the sons of the prophets sat at the feet of learned men of God, so many of us have had an opportunity to sit at the feet, if you will, in a classroom with Dr. George Voris. He poured into people literally now serving around the world that anointing, that wisdom, and even that wit that he had that brought a smile to every face. I'll never forget him. I have shared in several venues recently the first time that I met Dr. Voris. I was a young 21-year-old evangelist, scared, uncertain, not really ready to go into a church service that I had been invited to preach a revival in Gastonia, North Carolina at the Yorkwood Church. He picked me up at the airport and he drove me to that service. And before I got out of the car, not even realizing who he was or what he did as a college president, he said, "I want to pray for you. Be yourself. God is with you. You're going to be fine." And I've never forgotten that. I loved Dr. George Voris. You know, often we say at funerals, we have gathered because someone has died or passed away. But in this case, we have gathered because someone lived. And in living, Dr. Voris made a difference. Dr. Voris touched us all. And on behalf of the Church of God Executive Committee, I want you to hear me say, this man of God is honored today. He is loved and he is appreciated because of his investment in so many lives. God bless you. Our prayers are with you.
On behalf of the ministers and laypersons of the Churches of God in Western North Carolina, I do want to extend our sincere sympathy to George Jr. and Debbie and the rest of the Voris family. We share in your loss, but we're also grateful for his passing. I don't know of anyone who longed to leave this world as much as George Voris. After his ministerial activities were restricted by a stroke, he asked me one day when I was visiting with him, "What am I good for now? Why doesn't God just take me? I can't speak and I can't write. I'm good to nobody and I just want to go home." In fact, when friends would tell him they're praying for him, he would say, "Well, stop. I want to go to heaven. Stop praying for me." He wanted to catch COVID to speed him along the way. His longing to go reminded me of what Paul describes in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Paul said, "We know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven." Paul goes on to say in verse 8, "We are confident, I say, and willing, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." And this was his desire. I want to commend Debbie and Billy for taking care of him the way they did these last several years. In fact, Billy went above and beyond what a son-in-law would normally be called upon to do for his father-in-law. And George looked forward to George Jr.'s visits in the home. He was an outstanding minister, dedicated to God, to the Church of God, the Declaration of Faith, and to the ministry of the Churches of God in West North Carolina. He was elected to 11 two-year terms on the State Council. In fact, he was one of the youngest men ever elected to the Council and the first evangelist to be elected to the State Council of North Carolina. After his first term, he was elected every time he was eligible until he retired in 2002. For several years after his retirement, he received calls from former students where he would encourage them and even hosted students in his home where he talked to them and encourage them in the Lord and continue to mentor and encourage them. In the early years of his ministry, he served as an evangelist in Virginia and North Carolina. He was appointed the youth director of the New England States and served as a district overseer and pastored his first church in Portland, Maine. He later on pastored the then Lane Street Church of God in Kannapolis, the Morganton Church, the Wadesboro Church, and finally the Glenwood Church in Greensboro. He served on every elected board in North Carolina except the youth board. He spoke in 12 camp meetings, and according to Dr. Bill Coble, he wrote a total of 29 books, unpublished notes, and booklets. And although he only had a ninth grade education when he was saved, he went on to obtain the Bachelor of Arts, Bachelor of Divinity, Master of Divinity, Doctor of Ministry, and the Master of Education degrees. He taught for almost 30 years in the North Carolina Summer Bible School and Institute. And then in 1976, he became the founding president of East Coast Bible College, which he saw as his crowning achievement. In 2003, he was inducted into the prestigious Pentecostal Theological Seminary Hall of Prophets. His ministerial stats include nearly 6,000 sermons and nearly 1,400 conversions that were reported. Those numbers in themselves are significant, but they don't include the number of classes he taught, the number of hours he counseled, or the number of people he influenced. I knew him as my boss. He hired me to teach at East Coast Bible College for $8,000 for 9 months' work. And then when he resigned as the president and became a professor, we became colleagues, and eventually we became close friends. He was quick to make a first impression of someone and very slow to change that initial impression. He was the master of cut and paste before computers were even invented. He would cut up books, cut up sections, and paste them in his notebook as he prepared to write his different books. He's gone to a better place and been reunited with his wife, Margaret. He really missed Margaret. He never believed that she would go before him. He thought that she would always outlive him, and he realized how much he missed her once she was gone. Now, I can envision him when he got to heaven on December the 27th. He no doubt greeted Margaret, but then I can see him bowing down on his face before his Lord. He was so glad to see him. He's gone from this world, but he's left us a great legacy. When John D. Rockefeller, one of the wealthiest men in America, died, someone asked, how much did he leave behind? And the response was, all of it. Dr. Vorse never had a whole lot of money, but he always seemed to have enough money to take care of his needs and his family's needs. But he left a legacy worth far more than money. Enoch had a legacy that he walked with God. Ruth, a legacy of commitment. Elijah, a legacy of power and service. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, a legacy of uncompromising faith. Malachi, a legacy of financial integrity. And George Vorse, a legacy of Bible study and Bible exposition. Former overseer Harvey Turner commented, I would venture to say that in most congregations in West North Carolina, the mention of his name would be received with honor and respect because there would be someone there whose life had been touched in a positive way by this teacher-preacher. His legacy is reflected in the writings that remain. His books and notes have traveled around the world and are still being used to teach the word. Dr. Robert Daugherty, another former state overseer, wrote in his review of Dr. Vorse's book on the Pentateuch, as a result of his lifelong study and teaching, Dr. Vorse carries the reader through what are usually called difficult passages while sparing the reader the agony of endless research. While many authors convey only their personal opinion through their writings, Dr. Vorse carefully seeks to present a thorough analysis of differing theories. His legacy is also seen in the influence on so many lives. Those of you who we used to affectionately call the Vorseites are still out there with stories of their classroom experiences and Dr. Vorse test. Let me share just a few of the social media posts after his passing from former students and others that expressed this legacy. Robbie Spurlock wrote, Dr. V was one of my biggest heroes and mentors. I will never forget him, and I will continue to teach what he taught. Carl Overton wrote, "How many times have I sat in his class and heard him talk about heaven? Now he's there." Mike Wells wrote, "Your dad influenced my life in ministry early on as a student at ECBC. Many young men and women have gone forth in that college and are involved in Christian ministry today. His legacy lives on through each of them." Dr. Bill Coble wrote, "There's been no one I've learned more from about the Word of God, the ministry, and life than from him. Not only did I have every class of his at ECBC, but I also worked with him in his educational foundation. He inspired me to press on with my education to earn my doctorate. If there was no Dr. Voris, there probably would have been no Dr. Coble." Kim Gilly Franklin wrote, "You are so many things to so many people, teacher, preacher, mentor, counselor, and friend. You are so much more to me than that. You were active in my whole life. When I needed guidance, you were there. When I needed a confidant, you were there. Your wisdom and direction protected me from myself so many times. You poured into me when I was called to preach and cheered me on all the way. Then you poured into my son and did the same for him." And there are many, many more posts expressing similar sentiments. And that's a tremendous legacy. In fact, Debbie commented that she didn't need to write an obituary because all these posts served as a sufficient obituary for him. Now, I know words can mean very little at a time like this. There are no words that can alleviate the grief or the pain of his loss. But it's in times like these, when our world seems upside down, that the Holy Spirit steps in and comforts us and undergirds us with his love. There's a scripture I want to share with you. You don't usually hear this at a funeral, but it's the shortest verse in the Bible, John chapter 11, verse 35. The first one I learned to quote, "Jesus wept." The context of that was that Lazarus had gotten sick. Martha and Mary had sent word to Jesus that Lazarus was sick, asking him to come and pray for him. Jesus delayed his coming. Lazarus died and was buried. In fact, it was 4 days after his burial that Jesus showed up. And Martha, when she met him, she said, "Lord, if you had been here, our brother would not have died." Jesus asked him to take him to the gravesite, and you know the story. There at the tomb, Jesus wept. It's one of the mysteries of the incarnation that Jesus, the Son of God, became man. He experienced the grief that we experience when we lose a loved one. But there are three simple truths in this passage that I want to bring to you today very quickly. Number one, he's coming. Jesus didn't show up when they wanted to, but he did show up. And I tell you, in this world that we're living in, I think his message to us today is, "I'm coming. Yes, it's tough. I know what you're going through. I identify with what you're going through, and I'm coming. It may not be when you expect it, but I'm coming." A second thing we know about this is that he knows what's going on. He told his disciples Lazarus had died. He knew what was going on. He knows what's going on in the past, what's going on in the present, and what the future holds. And he does care. He knows. But even more than knowing, he cares. He loved Martha and Mary and Lazarus. And even though he knew he would raise him from the dead, he cared about their grief that they were experiencing. And let me close my remarks by saying what a wonderful friend he became to me and Bob Gilly. When we were teaching at East Coast Bible College together, we would often spend our lunch times together, and we would talk about the students, talk about administrators, talk about the Church of God, talk about world events. And then we would shoot a couple of games of pool or throw darts or play a card game. And he always say, "Let's play one more for the championship of the whole world." He loved to show us his study and the 3-inch binders where he had collected research to prepare for some book he was writing or some other topic. I've never met another man who studied more, read more, or wrote more. And I want to say a word about Evelyn Galloway, who would take his cut and paste and handwritten notes and type them up in a suitable format for printing, thereby helping to preserve them for posterity. And I also want to mention Olin Lee, whom Dr. Voris depended upon to publish his books for him. He touched many lives. He continues to teach through his publications. He continues to influence lives by his life, and his legacy will live on. God bless you.
I'm given the privilege that a whole lot of people would love to have, because all of us have got wonderful stories, testimonies about Dr. George Voris. Friend, teacher, pastor, supporter, encourager, mentor, educator, the list goes on and on. He was a lot of things to a lot of us, and we thank God for his life. I'm standing here to represent especially my role as his pastor and friend, and secondly, for the family. I'd like to say some things about the family first, because this was priority in Dr. Voris's life. His faith, his family, and his friends. His faith in God was priority. And if you haven't heard his testimony, you can see it. If you click in his name on Google, and you'll hear his testimony given at South Gastonia Church of God of how the Lord saved his soul. Raised as a Catholic, and how he couldn't go to a church, but a neighbor, Eva Bradshaw, introduced him to a tent revival. He said, a tent, that's a circus, I can go to that. So he did, he got saved. He's got a marvelous testimony, and it's a beautiful thing. You can hear that. I'd like to also say, several have contacted me about his books. The Home for Children in Kannapolis has what is remaining of all the books that he's written. And several are sold out, but there are some others that are left, including his autobiography. It's wonderful reading that'll bless your soul. Contact them, and you can purchase those there at the Home for Children in Kannapolis. He loved Margaret. He loved Debbie. He loved George Jr. His family was tight. He took care of them. He brought them up in the fear of the Lord. He ministered to them. Margaret, he looked after. Dr. Bell just talked about, he thought he would go first. He made arrangements to the best of human abilities to have everything set for her, so when he died, she'd be set, and she went before he did. So it got things turned around, and yet the arrangements he made, he ended up living in the quarters that he had prepared for his wife, and stayed there until not long afterwards, or not long before his passing, he was still there. So it was just something to see how God used him to take care of his family and his friends, especially his family. Debbie, Lord, have mercy, how this man loved you and looked up to you and helped you. He was so excited about you going into the counseling ministry and working with you for your doctorate and doing those things. He was so blessed with you, your family, the grandchildren. He just rejoiced in that. And George Jr., he loved you. He saw himself in you, and his prayers went up for both of you and your entire family. And in the book of Revelation, there is a vial at the throne room, and the angel told John that the fragrance is coming up out of that vial with the prayers of the saints. So the prayers he prayed for all of you, Debbie, George Jr., and all of the grandchildren and the family, those prayers are still effective, and they're still going up for you. He loved you dearly, and we thank God for all of you and your love. And he knew all of you loved him and were looking out for him. What a great man of God and a great family that he has. George Jr. posted something on his Facebook. He told me about it, and I asked him if I could read that at this memorial service. He is entitling it, My Dad, and it really reflects, a lot of it reflects those of us who felt like we were Brother Voris's spiritual children. And here's what it says. My dad, a man who came from nothing. God had his hand on you and directed your path. You are a great father, mentor, minister, and educator. You have influenced the life and thinking of thousands of people in your life. You taught me selfless love. You pushed and encouraged me to do anything I wanted in life. You taught me how to face life with logic and grace. It is with love and respect I say I love and appreciate the man you are and have been my whole life. I know I will not have you physically in my life for much longer. However, what you have taught me throughout my life will always be with me. I know whatever good I have in me was instilled in my heart by you and Mom. Thank you for being the man you are. Love you always, your son, George, and I'll say Junior. And what a testimony. I think a lot of us can relate to that as we know him as teacher, encourager, friend, guide in so many different ways. The memories we have will never be forgotten. I've watched him through the years as his pastor, as his health went down on him, and then the stroke, and then continuation of deterioration of his health. But he always kept believing and trusting in God. As his pastor, meeting with him, talking with him, praying with him, he lost a lot of his understandable speech, but I've been around him enough to know what he was trying to say, so I could read in between the words that were understandable to know what he was talking about. And we would be carrying on conversations, and he'd talk to me, and he'd look at me, and he'd say, "You know, Bob," he said, "I can struggle," and he would stop every now and then because he knew he wasn't getting out what he was thinking. But he said, "You know, every day in my devotions, I pray." And he said, "Those times when the Holy Ghost comes on me, he speaks through me just like he always did." And we would pray, of course, every time before I would leave. And most every time, the Spirit of God would give utterance through him. And it was the same language, same syllables that I would hear when the Spirit would move on him in church and services and when he was behind the pulpit. And I thought, how awesome it is that God was with him. I think that myself and Brother Barrett, one of my elders in the church, we visited Dr. Voris on Thursday afternoon. They called us on Friday and said they could not wake him up. I think by our visit with him, which was probably around 4:30 Thursday afternoon, we may have been the last visitors that he had beside the hospital help, of course. But he was in good spirit. He was talkative. He was laughing. And he was ready to go home, heavenly home. I looked at him. I said, "You're ready to make it to heaven, aren't you?" He said, "I'd go right now if the Lord would let me. I'm ready to go meet my maker." Those were the last words I heard from him when I walked out that hospital room. And I know that man made it. What a glorious, blessed man of God that he was, and the message that he left behind. He was a great member of the church. Of course, being a close friend, was also my boss when I worked at East Coast Bible College. And I think he continued to be as his pastor. So he was that kind of man with a dominant personality, and he was so influential. But he was always an encourager. He was always a supporter. He was always there for you, and you always left refreshed by being around him. He was a tremendous man of God, and he touched our entire church, from the littlest ones to even those that were being carried in arms. He would stop and talk with the mother or the father and pet that child. He would talk to the children. The young people loved him. They were flocking around him constantly. The young adults, the adults, and the senior citizens, everyone looked forward to seeing Brother Voris when he was able to be in church. What a wonderful time we had with him, and we have missed him by his not being able to be there, but we have prayed for him. He loved us. He loved our church. And he told our church the last few times he was with us, he said, "If you folks would quit praying for me, I could die and go on to heaven." That's what he wanted. But we kept praying for him because we were selfish enough to want to keep him with us. I can tell you this, his heart was prayed up, his mind was made up, his body was used up, his tithes were paid up, and then the Lord has taken him up. He is a man of God. He has fought a good fight. He was a soldier. He was a fighter. He did what is identified on the credentials of us Church of God ministers, which says we have authority to preach, teach, and defend the Word of God. He did it full force, but I'm going to add another one. Live the Word of God. And he taught us and gave us the example to do that. He was a wonderful man of God, a wonderful soldier, and he did what God put him here to do. I believe, as we have seen on the screen, as Brother Bell has mentioned, what the Apostle Paul says, I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, and what a fighter he was for the Lord and for what is right. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. So now he is rejoicing in heaven. Our church and myself are praying for Debbie and George and the entire family, and we're going to miss Brother Voris so much. But at the same time, I'm rejoicing for him because I know where he's at, and I'm going to see him again one day. If you have a testimony about what his ministry's done for you, I encourage you to put it on Facebooks all over the place. Send it out. Let people know their life has purpose and meaning, like Brother Voris, and they can influence and infect an entire generation, and not only this generation, but the time God is leaving for the rest of us. Use your faith and your testimony and tell everybody Jesus loves them and they can get saved, have abundant life, and then have eternal life in heaven. Brother Voris lived an abundant life, and then God gave him a promotion and he stepped out of abundant life into eternal life. Because a child of God never dies, we just get promoted. God bless you.
Good afternoon. We are Lee and Tammy Storms, and we are honored to be asked to speak at Dr. Voris's memorial. Tammy was one of his favorites, and he made it very clear that I was second fiddle. He'd tease that I was allowed entrance only because of Tammy.
Dr. Voris was president of East Coast Bible College when I first met him at 19 years old. In 1978, Sister Voris was dean of the college, dean of women at the time. I felt called to go to Bible college, born out of a desire to really know the Word of God and to be established in the faith. Not being raised in church, I wanted to see Christian relationships in action. And little did I know that God would take that desire in my heart and allow me the privilege to develop relationships that would span for the next 40 years. I not only got to see, but I got to experience Christian relationships through Dr. and Sister Voris. They were like Jesus to me, and then to my children, especially our oldest.
Tammy always felt great love from Dr. Voris, and once our kids came along, he loved on them the same way. He especially took our son James under his wing. James was not serving the Lord, and he had some challenges with church people. But somehow, he felt safe and loved by Dr. Voris. And when he was approached by Dr. V to study the Bible with him, he said yes. James would go after work once a week, and they'd study God's Word together. James did paving work out in the hot sun. By the end of the day, he was sweaty and pretty ripe. Dr. Voris wanted him to come straight to his house from work, but I encouraged him to stop and get a quick shower first. I got a call from Dr. V telling me he didn't want James to have to jump through any hoops to come to his house, and for me to, he said it in the nicest possible way, but he told me to butt out. Attempting to listen, but still have my son show respect to Dr. Voris, I suggested that he, at very least, bring a beach towel to sit on. I got another call from Doc. Again, he stressed that I needed to stay out of it. He said he would rather have my son. Comfortable in his home studying God's word than have a perfectly spotless couch. I complied. I'll close my comments by saying James is pursuing Jesus today, largely because of God's love that he felt from Doc.
I'm grateful and thankful, feeling like the least of these, but always so blessed by Dr. and Sister Voris. And I thank his family for sharing him with all of us, with all of his students. He loved you and he spoke of you every time we would meet. My son James and I had the honor sitting with him several hours before he drew his last breath here on earth. He finished his race. May we all finish strong till we see him again. And may we all be found faithful. Thank you.
I want to say to Debbie and George, thank you for the privilege of being able to speak this afternoon. I have a really large lump in my throat. I knew this day was coming, and I knew that he wanted it to come, but somehow seeing these pictures on the screen, that collage of his life just kind of got a hold of me today. I remember I think it was in the mid-60s that we found out in the Wadesboro Church of God that George Voris was coming to be our pastor. We were in awe of this man. And he told me how it came about. He said he had gone to the state overseer to ask for a church he wanted to pastor. And he told Sister Voris, the first church he offers me, I'm going to take it. In fact, the first church he mentions, I'm going to tell him I want it. So he went to the state overseer's office that day and sat down, and the overseer said, so you want a pastor? He said, I've got several churches. He said, there's this Wadesboro church, but you don't want that one. He said, I'll take it. And the overseer, and you guys can see him doing that, the overseer said, no, Brother Voris, you don't want that church. He said, I'll take it. And he took it. And he told me years later that he knew why the Lord sent him to that church. We had a small but dedicated group of young people there. And he is the reason I'm standing here today. He had a profound effect on me. I could mention all of the other young people. In fact, he does mention them in his book called Mighty Through God. And he was in awe of how God used all of these young people in that ministry that he so freely and selfishly gave to us. I opened this book a while ago, and I read this again. He said, all of those kids in the Wadesboro Church I love with all of my heart, but Loran had a special place in my heart. I knew without a shadow of a doubt that God had his hand on Loran. When preaching revivals, I insisted on him going with me. He traveled several churches with me and ran the slide projector as I lectured on my trip to Europe and the Holy Land. I involved him in several facets of ministry for the years I pastored in Wadesboro. And then he says, I regard the privilege of mentoring Dr. Livingston as the highest accomplishment in my ministry. He still regards me as his pastor and visits me frequently since my disability keeps me close to home. We discuss scriptures and the problems of ministering in these last days, and it goes on and on. And boy, did we discuss them. And you know, when I got to be a big boy with Dr. Voris, we could actually debate, and we could get loud, and we could argue, and that was quite a treat to be able to do that with the man that you held in such a high esteem when you were only 14 years old. I remember that day that we found out he was coming. There were a couple of the young people there that had been to summer Bible school, and they came back. For you that don't know, that lasted a month. We actually were in Bible school for a month, and we went to classes, and we stayed in dorms, and you could pass, and you could fail. Dr. Voris was one of the professors, and his classrooms were always packed. And they would come back from Bible school and say, you ought to hear this guy, this Dr. Voris, teach Daniel and Revelation. And so when we found out he was coming to be our pastor, we were extremely excited. I remember one time, not long after he arrived, I was at home, and my mother and dad were in their room praying. And I want Debbie and George to know this. I heard my dad thanking God that he sent the Voris family to Wadesboro. My parents felt like that was our salvation. And for almost 5 years, that man poured his soul and the knowledge of his word, God's word, into that church. Oh, I don't know that a church had ever been more honored to have a pastor than we were. I was so fascinated by this ex-Roman Catholic from Brooklyn, the accent he still had, the testimony of his salvation. And I could not get my head or hands around this man who could quote scripture at the drop of a hat. You give a verse, he can quote the scripture. He can explain the scripture. And that fascinated me to no end. He was involved in my wedding. Sandra and I were privileged to have Dr. Voris aid her father as we became husband and wife and went on to serve the Lord. I am deeply grateful to God. I know without any doubts that he sent George Voris into my life. Not long ago, I was invited to preach in Brooklyn, and I made up my mind that I was going to find the street where George Voris grew up. I found the street, but I couldn't find the housing area. But I stood there one day and thought, this is in Brooklyn, New York. And it was a cool day, and I was wrapped up, and I stood there and I thought, decades ago, a young Catholic Dutch, German Dutch, I believe he said he was, boy, walked these streets. He had no father, and his mother was an alcoholic. And this young boy would get on the subway and go to Manhattan. This is what he told me. And he would go to Broadway and go to the theaters and ask for a job to work behind the curtains. He did that for many years. And I thought, little did he know that God Almighty had put his hand on his life and that he would leave Brooklyn and that he would marry Sister Esteline and that he would have George and Debbie and begin a ministry and then come to a place, a small place, a really backward place, like Wadesboro, North Carolina, and have such a profound effect on so many young people. I thank the Lord for him. I thank the Lord for his effect on my life. And I, again, join with these other pastors and friends. While there are tens of thousands of people who could stand up here today and honor Dr. George Voris, I'm just very happy to be one of those. So, George, Debbie, We all grew up together down there. We all went through stuff together. And you had no idea that your dad was shaping lives for not only this life, for eternity. So I'm happy to be here today to say these things about your father. He was my friend. He was a great part of my life. He is a reason I'm in this pulpit today. And I pray for your comfort, your fond memories, and just know that one of these days, and I don't think it's going to be long, there really is going to be a great reunion in heaven. And we're going to dance around the throne of God, the feet of Jesus. So thank you again for inviting me to be a part of this. And for all of you that knew him, we all say together, thank you, Jesus, for sending George Voris into our lives.
I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind. It's close than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call. And at the midnight cry, we'll be going. I look around me and I see prophecy fulfilling. Oh, yes, I do. The signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. Yeah, I can almost see. Father, as he said, son, go get my children, get my children. And at the midnight cry, the bride of Christ shall rise. Yeah. When Jesus steps out on a cloud to call his children, the dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air. And then those that remain shall be quickly changed. Oh, yes, we will. At the midnight cry, we'll be going home. Thank you. I look around me and I see prophecy fulfilling. It won't be long now. The signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. Yeah, I can almost see. Choose.
I feel that resurrection power that took Brother Boris home the other day. Romans 8 and 11, but if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, then he that raised up Jesus shall also quicken your mortal bodies by that same spirit. Spiritually at conversion, but also physically at the resurrection, he's coming. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes on me, though he dies, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the life and ministry of Dr. George Voris, his lovely wife, and his family. We thank you for the testimony, the legacy, the ministry, the impact, the several generations that he has impacted through his knowledge of the word and the instruction, preaching, teaching, and defending of it. We thank you for his faithfulness. And we thank you, Lord, for his commitment and dedication and example he has given to us as a good soldier of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we thank you for the gift of Dr. George Voris. You know the treasure he has been for so many of us. It's not easy to part with him, but we know his heart and his longing was to be with you in heaven. Thank you for giving him the answer to his prayer. And now we ask you to help us for our journeys that remain. Memories are here to help us. We ask you to heal the hurt in the hearts of those that need to look to you, hold on to you, prepare their hearts and lives for heaven as well. We ask you, Lord, to shepherd us through our ministries, through our callings, through our testimonies, and bind us together in the Word of God that our faith in you will intensify. We will go forward with your strength to sustain us. Grant us your unconditional love, your everlasting mercy, your amazing grace, and your stabilizing peace. We ask it all in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And we shout amen to you, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, 3 in 1. Amen and amen. God bless you.